I mean, I think it's probably been one of the biggest shows I've done ever.
I'm here with Rebecca Lee and Sanna Seppanen from the makeup artists and hairstyling departments of Shogun. I just finished watching episode 10, so I just saw the end of it finally. I've been around long enough to remember the original Shogun miniseries back in the day. Obviously, it's been forever since I've seen it. But what an amazing shoot. I had to remind myself a few times when watching it. It's like, oh, this is Vancouver where this is shot. This is not Asia. This is not Europe, somewhere else. What a great location for that. When did you shoot Shogun?
No, we didn't finish in January. We finished the last summer.
July of 2022.
So it's been almost 2 years since you said that's when you finished?
Right. Correct.
Wow, it took a long time for that to hit the screen. Is there a reason why it was that long for them to edit and to get it ready? That 2 years, long time.
Well, there's something about trying to make it look like feudal Japan. They might have had a few buildings to erase in some of the sets.
I was given, that it was a lot of the visual effects took a long time.
And how long was the shoot?
10 months. It was 10 months of shoot, but also the incredibly long prep. I mean, I started talking to them in January of the previous year. Rebecca and I were actually on Pachinko and started having chats with the producers then about the concepts for the show. And we started to flush out concepts and really get into prep by May of the previous year. So it was a more than a full year commitment.
Yeah, this is not your normal talking head kind of picture to shoot. Everything is Japanese and from 1600s, am I right? Is that the time period?
Yeah. Late 1500s, very 1590.
I was thinking wardrobe, makeup, hair, the sets, everything. It's quite an undertaking to be, to create this environment. Great. I would love to hear about the wigs for the men as well as the women. The women are usually for a period piece. It's very involved. For men, maybe not so much. But I think for your show, I think the men were probably equally as significant as maybe even more so than the women. Please tell us about the wigs.
So the wigs, many of the wigs came from Japan. The hairstyle is called the nakazori. It's the shaved bald on top and the hair is swept up into a mage ponytail. That mage ponytail is a style that is used often in television and in film in Japan. So they have wig rental houses that have thousands of these wigs. We rented, I think we sent 1,000 over and used 700 of them. And then, that is like, some of these are actually like an art piece. They're signed on the inside with the production and the actor. And we actually found an original one from Shogun, the movie, from James Clavell's 1978 production. We found one of the original pieces. So these have been preserved and maintained like pieces of art. And so we had 700 of those that we used on many of the background and some of the day players. But we also go ahead.
No, go ahead. Finish that piece and then I have a question.
Okay. We also made a hybrid version. So this technique of building a wig, it's a metal frame that is fitted to the cast, to the actor's head. Then the hair is laid on top and then it's pulled into the mage. And so the metal frame makes it strong enough to hold the weight of the ponytail and not to move, because this style had to be very proud and very strong and it doesn't really mess up. And so therefore we can't have sort of our way of storytelling, which has a little more texture and a little bit more movability in the hair. And so we made a hybrid version where I took the theatrical style of a cage for the frame of the wig and then put the hair over. But the hair was hand tied to lace the way that we typically do so that it could fall out and it could move and it could get messy and wet and they could jump into the ocean and swim like you saw some of the cast do, I think, in episode 4, without it falling apart or damaging it, because the traditional ones are very fragile.
I can imagine. I was fortunate to be Mitsuyoshi Cosmetics brought me over to Tokyo back in the day. And that they took me around to different television studios and things to visit and tour and see. And they said, there's a makeup artist that wants to show you how he does a bald cap. But I said, oh, okay, well, great. Because I've done a lot of bald caps. And so they brought me over to him and he put a stocking cap on the fella's head. And then he started gluing it to his head. And I'm going, I'm thinking, what is this? And when's the cap going on? And then I went, oh, this is going to be very theatrical looking. This isn't going to look very good at all. And then he took a pan stick and went over it and filled it all in. I was shocked and amazed at how fast he was able to do a bald cap and how good that cap ended up looking. I'm looking at some of your photos. It looks like you guys utilize that technique somewhat. True?
We sure did. We definitely, and Rebecca can answer to this even more, but we absolutely started there and then we finessed it for some of the other looks. But Rebecca, why don't you take it away with the process of bald caps?
That sounds very much like the Habutai process of doing a bald cap. Very similar anyways. We certainly used elements like that. Not starting with a stocking cap, but sheets of very fine silk with straps on them that were covered with a special Japanese wax. These fine sheets of silk were placed on the head and then strapped at the back. And Sanna's beautiful wigs went over top of that. And I think traditionally, yes, you're right, the pan stick would do the blend, quite a heavy blend. And it is quite incredible what can be done with that. We found for our filming in HD, in high-def cameras, we wanted to perfect it even just a little bit more. So what we did was created a blender piece out of Bondo. So we sculpted a piece kind of like this out of Bondo so the silk piece would come to about here and we would place this Bondo blender just there. And that really helped to blend the seam and also for speed, because sometimes blending with the pan stick and the wax took a little bit of extra time. And so the blender sped things up and also just gave us that seamless finish. And then the coloration over the whole thing.
Well, it looked great. I mean, I try to watch mostly as a viewer, but of course, as a makeup artist, I'm going to look at once in a while going, yeah, that looks pretty good there. I was wondering, did you use any more of our traditional bald caps in the show at all? Or was it all really more of this Japanese style? Were you using any plastic caps or rubber caps? Or was it was all this?
We didn't use, I can't think of one plastic cap that we used. We did, however, for the leads, some of the leads, use some silicone custom caps. So not everybody had the Habutai silk bald cap. Toby Lindala did custom bald caps for some of our leads, definitely.
That makes sense to me. I figure that's what it would be. You have so many people to do. And the Japanese technique is perfect for getting so many background out in that way. But yeah, some of them are with the way cameras are now, it's pretty critical and a lot of scrutiny that happens there. Did anybody offer to shave their head?
We got a couple shaved heads, but months before, like Rebecca said, Toby Lindela, and I started developing those silicone top pieces months before we went to camera, because we had to find a way to hang these incredibly heavy wigs off of the silicone. So that was a whole intricate process, just to be able to stabilize that wig and then blend it into the silicone top. And then we had, how many actors shaved their heads? We actually were offering money for background to shave their heads. We were trying to buy some scalp.
I have a cultural question that I don't, some of the men, their heads are shaved on top and some are not. Why is that?
Well, the nakazori is the shaved hair and the sohatsu is the hair that is not shaved. When it's a full head of hair that's pulled up into the same hairstyle. So the nakazori, the shaved head was done specifically for warriors so they wouldn't sweat during battle. That's why they started to do that. So the hair was removed to eliminate some of the sweat that would drip out from underneath the helmets. And so the nakazoris were a very regal and proud hairstyle. And a lot of the villagers would recognize them instantly. And so the soldiers who chose to do the nakazori hair were instantly recognized as warriors. And the sohatsu was used also, but not as much. The nakazori became the norm for most of the soldiers, but some of them still just did pull their hair back into a sohatsu, depending on, a lot of it depended on rank and where they were from. And typically most of, in all the paintings that we looked at, the warriors that wore the nakazori were sort of like lower ranks, elevating themselves. Some of the sohatsus, you just didn't see them as much. We chose to use them as a storytelling point. That Torenaga and that his allegiance, his ideals are something a little bit out of the norm. He's not really towing the line. He's a bit more of a unique individual during this time.
But like Takehiro, he didn't shave his head though, his character. Yeah, I'm just trying to understand the cultural difference there. Why was he not considered a warrior?
No, we're using it as a storytelling point. And he comes from more of the same way of thinking that Torunaga wanted to, the way he saw bringing Japan together and bringing Japan into like their next, I'm not explaining this very well, like, politically how they would move the country into a better position. So there were the real warlord, old school style of leadership. And then Torunaga wanted to be something different. And so we used that for him. And then also for anyone that we wanted to have that more sympathetic style character to.
How long did it take to get the men ready each day? People that are, that are part of your primary cast?
They would start by having their hair wrapped with Sanna, right? And then go to makeup effects for silicone. These are the lead ones that have silicone bald caps. And those took about an hour. I think, Sanna, would you say about 2 hours?
Yeah, tops. I think we got it down to a pretty quick hour 15, hour and a half. So we were getting a lot of cast done very quickly. And with the background, man, we'd get a few hundred background done in a couple hours. Mm-hmm. We got this. We had a well-oiled machine.
It was by far the biggest challenge I think we faced. And I remember being quite worried about how we were going to do so many background every morning. And we could do 300 a day of these habutai. And I think we got them down to probably 30 minutes for the application of the actual cap and then all the makeup that went with that and the scars and the wigs and everything. We could get each background done in probably 45 minutes, 50 minutes.
How many makeup and hair people were on the show?
We had 25 each in background. So 50 in BG, and then on main team, there was a dozen. So 75, a department of 75 combined.
Six or eight trailers at the circus for processing. So four for hair and four for makeup, for processing the cast. And massive tent structures. They were really structures for processing for the background.
Now, this show had a fair amount that was exterior. But there is some interiors that were happening. Where did you guys shoot for stages?
We had three stages that we primarily shot in. There's a studio called Mammoth that was where fundamentally all our filming was done. And then we built a big village along a river. But we were outside a lot. And this was the year of the atmospheric river. And, you know, Vancouver rains a lot anyway. And this was no joke. It came down in buckets. We were standing outside on the side of a mountain, knee deep, horses, stuntmen, samurai, and then nobles. And I was like, I'm so grateful for my department and my team. These people didn't look like drowned rats. And it was absolutely pouring. It was the most heartbreaking thing. You see all this beautiful work, those incredible costumes, magnificent props, walking out onto the side of this mountain, way up high in the mountains, an absolute torrential downpour where you're like knee deep, thigh high in mud. Horses are sliding. Stuntmen are going to the hospital because they're getting stepped on by the horses. It was wild. It was about as messy and dangerous as it gets.
Well, the one good thing out of that is Vancouver, you have it being all overcast, so you get this perfectly diffused light that is definitely a character of the show and the look of it, which was really, really wonderful. I enjoyed the cinematography. I thought, I figured there was going to be a lot more battles. It seemed like they were leading up. They're always talking about wars and everything's that there really wasn't that much warfare. This is a character-driven project.
Yeah, it's a love story. It's a story about cultural clash. It's a story about all sorts of different societies and different sects of people coming together and how they're accepting and understanding of this traditional, incredible historical country. And then how they're finding their way in it, trying to control or manipulate or dominate the currency or society or people. And so it's a character story. And I know a lot of people, I hear that a lot from men, especially like, I kept wanting them to go to battle and getting texts and emails saying, hey, what's going to happen? But don't tell me, but is there a battle coming?
But Toronaka didn't want to go to war. And he spoke about that. And his young son was often like, let's fight, let's fight. And some of those great scenes were him explaining to his son, like, why that wasn't the ideal. And it's only someone who's never been that really wants to go to war.
And Anna is such a big part of the story. And there's a lot of really tight close-ups on her and various lighting, all these things that were happening. What type of makeup were you using for her?
So we were very fortunate. This was our second project with Anna in a row. So I had Pachinko was the first TV show that Sanna and I both did with her, filmed mostly in Korea. So when we met with Anna, it was meeting up with a friend, and I knew her skin well already. I knew what skincare we needed for her. I knew what she liked. What we were trying to do with Shogun was emulate what would have been worn in 1590. So face makeup was made with rice powder. Black for the brows and liner was from charcoal. And the lip color was made from the saffron flower. So we used our modern day products to try and find those colors. And actually used a Kojendo foundation, the Kojendo primer first in lavender, just to really even out the skin tone, and then a pale foundation to give that porcelain look to the skin. And then I actually custom blended a color to match what the saffron lipstick would have been like, because I couldn't find exactly what we needed. It might have looked close in a swatch, but with the HD cameras, we couldn't find exactly that depth and that color that isn't quite red, it isn't quite pink, and it's not orange. It was really in between. So that was a mixture of four colors to achieve that look.
Great that you already had a previous working relationship with her. Probably was one of the reasons why you guys ended up on the project. So good for you.
I'd like to think so. Yeah, it certainly meant we had a shorthand very quickly So that really helped a lot. It also helps that she's just the loveliest person to work with too. Extremely considerate. Sometimes actors will look down at their phone and you say, "Can you keep your head up? I can't quite get to your face." Or sitting up straight, would turn to me and just try to make my job as easy as possible. So it was very special working with her.
I have not worked on a project that's almost entirely foreign language. Was that kind of odd for you guys?
Yeah, it was. It's tricky. Knowing the script really well obviously really helped, and having dozens of interpreters at every turn also is a great assistance. It's watching it on camera is one thing, but when you really see the actors emote, you follow along, and knowing the story, it's almost like you can understand what they're saying. We had such a talented cast. But it got really tricky, at base camp when you're working with Japanese actors who don't speak English very well, and you're trying to talk about the intricacies and the details of the character they're portraying and what they want to bring to screen and how sympathetic or empathetic we want to make them, and style detail. And then, of course, hierarchy and rank, where they would fall. But they were so lovely to work with. It was an absolute joy. And everybody was so enthusiastic. Yeah, and all the cast were just game. They were so excited to be here on a big American TV show. It was so incredibly exciting for everyone who was involved.
Did you use any products to minimize pores?
We did use some primers. We did. We were very lucky. Especially the women had the most incredible skin. So there wasn't a huge need for that. But for some of those really close shots, we did use a milk primer. For perfecting primer, which was very nice. And then also the Kogendo primer bases, corrector colors, those did a little bit of pore softening as well. We used the lavender and the pink a lot to even skin tone and get that porcelain look. So we did do a little bit of that, but you just can't be too heavy-handed. Has to be so light, and we wanted the makeup to be there and to tell part of the story, but never to be distracting or thick or heavy. So it was definitely a balance, and that's part of the reason. I don't know if you're familiar, there's a couple of techniques that we left out of our story that were used in that time in feudal Japan. The women would, after getting married, it was a certain age, would paint their teeth black using a mixture of, I think, lead and charcoal. That was horrible. They felt this was very beautiful, the stunning red lip and a black tooth. The other thing they did was shave their eyebrows and place them and smudge the eyebrows up high. You may have seen these images sometimes. And we thought a lot about this because authenticity was so important to this picture. We just felt that to a modern day sensibility, that would maybe be too much and certainly a lot to ask an actor to or an actress to do. So there were some things that were left out.
I have never heard of that. I think it's pretty odd anyway, a culture where the men want to shave the top of their heads. Usually we're trying to prevent that from happening. So that's already a thing. And then now you tell me about this, about women making their teeth black. I can't imagine that being considered very attractive, but it is a foreign culture. Now, in episode one, we start off with John's crew on the ship, and they're, it's quite a different look from what we see in the rest of the show, where people are pretty fastidious and clean and well manicured. They've been on the sea, they're starving and scurvy and all that going on. So that's a nice contrast of did you enjoy doing those scenes on the ship?
Yeah, absolutely. And I'm glad you could see that, because that was very much on purpose to show the difference between the way the Dutch were when they would have arrived there. And like you say, the fastidiousness of the Japanese people. So the scurvy was great. We had some Bondo pieces and lots of deep sort of decomposing skin and really bad teeth, bleeding gums. It's just a nice contrast to do some fun special effects.
Yeah.
And story-wise, just the fact that they show up in such a horrible state, yet they're calling the Japanese savages and talking about how incredibly savage Japan is. The dichotomy of that between the two cultures was such a fantastic representation of the ego of mankind, let's say.
That is something, because they're constantly calling Cosmo a barbarian, and you know, especially Japanese culture at that time, seeing anyone as not Japanese as a barbarian. So especially if he shows up and he looks like a drowned rat. It's actually a great character arc, going back to, like, you know, the Cosmo character. We see him when he's long hair and long beard, and he's been through all that, and by the end he has he's learned to speak a decent amount of Japanese, enough to kind of make his way. He's a bit handicapped at the end, not having Mariko at his side, but you know, he makes it through. He's an interesting character, and in the story arc we see him change, you know, as well, his appearance, along with this change perhaps in his behavior. It's something when he finally catches up with his crew that they're estranged to him.
Mm-hmm.
He's been spending his entire time with Japanese people for however long that's supposed to have transpired. And his crew is still kind of the scurvy dogs that they were when he left them. And I was surprised that we never did see like a reuniting or him getting with any of them. He just seemed to reject them after running into the one fellow that was drunk and in a mess. I don't think he had vision for it anymore.
Now realizing the evolution that he'd been on, his character, and how evolved he had become with the refinement of the Japanese culture. You know, when we first started, like you said, he came with his long, messy hair and straggly beard. And then the Japanese cleaned him up and bathed him and shaved him and chopped away his hair kind of roughly with a knife. We left that really sort of crude and rough. And then, as you say, he got refined and runs into his old crewmates and realizes he has nothing in common with them. And they really are the savages the Japanese have been referring to them as since, yeah. Quite a difference.
But the characters that end up having the silicone bald caps, and then they've got things done, whereas people from Toby's team, were they there to maintain those, or did you guys take it from what's okay? You're nodding. That is,
we looked after a little bit. Sometimes some of the makeup team helped with silicone as well, but Toby also had a full team there. Brianne Leto, Caitlin Groves, Susie, whose last name I'm forgetting, they were with us the whole time as well, and they maintained those. It was great team environment. We all worked really well together. And, you know, also the Japanese crew that we had with us as well, too. So it was a great experience that way. Everybody did what needed to be done.
Oh, now tell me about the Japanese crew.
It was an incredible collaboration between the East and the West. So we had a couple of wig technicians come from Japan. We had three wig technicians with Michi, who's an expert in the Japanese traditional wig application, as well a couple other technicians who were so fantastic at shaping and forming the metal around the actor's head and tweaking that and maintaining those beautiful pieces of art that they've so meticulously maintained for decades and used in so many shows. So the wig houses actually, I don't believe they would have lent them or rented those wigs to us without a technician to come and maintain them to make sure that they returned in the same order that they came in.
Makes sense. Because they've rented it to those people before and they have a relationship with them. So they're willing to let them come out.
Yeah, exactly.
And we had to learn how to do the habutai. It wasn't something we could just watch a video. The Japanese technicians were there to teach all sort of, I think there were about 35 of us in the end. So step by step, how to not only apply them, but to maintain them, clean them, prep them for the next day, sew them, because we did go through quite a few and had to make new ones with the silk and the wax. So we couldn't have done that part of it without them. And then, you know, we collaborated and added some of our own touches to it. But the base of the concept and the habutai itself came straight from Japan and those Japanese technicians.
And you had a decent amount of fake heads. I don't think I've seen a show with as many fake heads in a long time. I take it Toby's department took care of those.
That's right. All the chopped off heads.
Yeah.
Tell me about the dream sequences that Cosmo was having as he was going in and out of consciousness, and he sees himself late in life and with children and obviously back in England and what have you. So we only ended up seeing like two clips of that. Was there more that was shot of that, or is that all that was intended?
No, that was all that was shot. It was all very purposeful. That's what was shot, and you saw all of it. Yeah. And that was an age makeup that Toby and his team did for Cosmo. Fantastic job. And I think, yeah, it was interesting to see that. I don't remember if the original story had anything like that in it. I don't believe so.
No, it didn't. That was an extra twist on the story. I think that really was inspired by Cosmo and him, his conversations with the director on what would happen if he had returned back to England and was sort of in hindsight thinking about his time in Japan, and they'd come up with a couple of different endings, and that was one of the one that Cosmo was really pushing for and was quite passionate about, including this character old and longing for his life in Japan.
Just
was supposed to be a dream sequence. Is that what that is?
It was sort of very ambiguous when we shot it, whether that was something that actually occurred or whether that was just a dream or whether that was a glimpse into the future. And so, yes, it was just a dream sequence.
And is there a season two, or is this a one-off?
They're writing. FX has got Justin and Rachel writing. You know, there was talk. When we first started this project, they had talked about possibly using other James Clavell stories for extra seasons. But now people have just fallen in love with the characters. I think they're so blown away with the response. The response is obviously overwhelming. And so they've asked them to start writing a season two. So we'll see what happens.
Well, ladies, thank you for taking the time to talk to us about Shogun. It's a very, very special project, and I think it really stands out as being a kind of a unique piece that's there right now. I mean, people have a lot of choices of things to watch, and it's been interesting for me to talk to people in my circle that they're not in our business to hear them talk about Shogun. Oh, yeah, I hear that's really good, and you want to see that. So thanks for giving me the incentive to watch it, because I really, really enjoyed it. Our family enjoyed it watching it as well.
Wonderful. That's awesome. That's so great. Yeah. Wonderful to hear.
Thank you for your time. And we're so glad that you enjoyed the show.
Yep. Thank you guys much.